As Tom said, I've written two books with Robin. This is the trade paperback edition of his memoirs. He, as you saw, he passed away in 2010, and so we brought this out this year with a new foreword and a little bit of new material, some new photos, and a new title. So what I want to talk to you tonight for a few minutes about is sort of how heroes and hero worshiping and how sometimes dreams can come true. Most of the men in the audience, if not all, have heroes in life as boys and growing up. And sometimes those heroes are your dad or a relative, an uncle. In my case, it was an uncle. But sometimes they're larger in life figures, athletes, pro athletes. And so Robin fit the bill for me in that regard. So you heard a lot about his career, and just a couple of more things. He was along with Warren Spahn, the dominant pitcher in the 1950s, won 20 or more games 6 years in a row. His best year was 1952, when he was 28 games and lost seven. And the next winningest pitcher in the league that year won 18 games. So he had 10 wins more than the next winningest pitcher. And that year he was named the Sporting News Player of the Year. Six straight years he pitched more than 300 innings, unbelievable today. 346 innings in 1953, that was his peak. He was the opening day pitcher 13 different years. And I think the thing that the stat that sort of blows me away is that at one point he won 28 straight. He didn't win. I'm sorry. He pitched 28 straight complete games over two seasons. 28 straight. I mean, no team has that many complete games these days, or anywhere close to it. He actually was on the cover of Time magazine, as well as, of course, all kinds of sporting. Sports magazines. Red Shandy once said that his fastball was like it was on a sheet of ice. As those great materials said, he had great control and didn't walk anybody and struck out a lot of people. Also, set the record. He really didn't like to talk about this a whole lot, but he gave up more home runs than any other pitcher in Major League Baseball history until Jamie Moyer came along a couple of years ago. And I know Robin would have been thrilled to know that record had been broken. He really was a fly ball pitcher because his fastball had a hop on it and a lot of fly balls. Some of them just went a little too far. Well, my relationship, I tuned into baseball in 1956 when I was 8 years old. And for some reason, I'm not really sure, Robin Roberts became my hero almost instantly. And I grew up in Wyoming until high school, and there's no baseball around there, no professional baseball close by. But I had a grandfather in the Philadelphia area. That may have had something to do with it, although I didn't have much contact with him. And I think I like those red pinstripe uniforms. I think that may have been. And I figured out Robin Roberts was the best player on that team. Now, if you know anything about the Phillies, they won the pennant in 1950, the Whiz Kids. Robin was a star on that team. But by the late 50s, they were pretty dreadful. They weren't very good, and Robin was sort of tailing off. He was on the downside. So I learned early on to root for the underdogs. Because the Phillies were not very good. And of course, that's been excellent training since I've been a professor at SMU all these years, rooting for the Ponies. So he was my guy. And when I was 11 in the spring of 1960, out of the blue, I got a letter from Robin Roberts. Now, he'd been my hero for 4 years. And I got a letter he sent from Clearwater Spring Training and telling me to, you know, that he knew I was a pitcher. He'd heard I was a pitcher and hoped that I would, win a lot of games and don't throw any curves yet. And just a really newsy letter. And so I was, obviously absolutely thrilled. Later, I think I know what happened. I think my grandfather knew somebody with the Phillies, and I think they typed up the letter and handed it to him and said, "Here, sign this, and we'll mail it." But nonetheless, it had a great effect on me. In 1961, Robin sort of hit the bottom, and he won one game and lost 10 that year, and he had a great recovery and pitched, won 52 or four more games for the Baltimore Orioles, and he pitched for the Astros as well, and had a good last part of his career. But that year he was 1-10. When I met him the first time, we were having breakfast, and I said, "You know, at 61, I was 12, 13 years old." And I said, "Boy, I really suffered through that season." And he said, "How do you think I felt?" So I got the letter in 1960. So fast forward to 1992, 32 years later, is when I met him, when I actually got to meet him. And a friend of mine, Talmadge Boston, invited me out to a Rangers Old Timers luncheon in June. And Bob Gibson was the speaker, and I thought that'd be nice to go hear him. So I went out to the luncheon, and it's a big ballroom at the Sheraton Hotel out there, and we're, you know, the luncheon started, and in walks Robin Roberts into the room, and all of a sudden, you know, I was the dean of the law school then, well into my 40s, and all of a sudden I had sweaty palms, I lost my appetite, I couldn't sit still, and just because he was in the same room. And Talmadge said, after lunch, we got to meet him. You got to meet him, because he knew that Robin was my guy. So afterwards, we sort of followed him, out of the ballroom. He'd signed a bunch of autographs, and when he finally got done, he was leaving the ballroom, and he was heading for some elevators. And so Talmadge walked. He's a lot more aggressive than I am. He's a litigator. Walked up and said, "Mr. Roberts, Paul Rogers is here, and he's the dean of the law school, and you're his boyhood hero. Would you have time to have a Coke with us?" And I'm actually behind a pillar. I'm embarrassed. When he said my name, I finally said, "You know, you got to be a man about this." And so I walked up and followed Talmadge. And so Robin said, "They've got a tea time for us. I don't have time to have a Coke." He said, but why don't you come out and have breakfast with me in the morning? And so, you know, they didn't have to ask us twice. So we did. We went out and had a 2-hour breakfast. And it was, you know, it was just wonderful. What transpired was, I'd always thought I would write a baseball book or books after I retired from being a law professor. I read enough baseball books, and I thought, you know, I'll write one. Well, it occurred to me literally in the shower one morning that nobody had written a book about the Whiz Kids, and all the books have been written about the Dodgers and the Yankees of that era, but nobody had written about the Phillies. And I now knew Robin Roberts, and maybe he would want to write a book about it. He talked at breakfast about how special that team had been in his career. It was the pinnacle of his career, and he was only 22 or 3 that year. And so I called him up, and I said, "You know, why don't we work together and collaborate on a book about the Whiz Kids?" And he said immediately, "Let's do it. What a great idea." And I always say I feel like the dog that chases the car and catches it. You know, what do I do now? But we collaborated, and it was our collaboration turned into a friendship and into a second book. Had some wonderful experiences with Robin. We started the book. I flew up and met him in Philadelphia. He lived in Tampa, but met him in Philadelphia. He said, "We got to talk to Eddie Sawyer." Eddie Sawyer was the manager of the Whiz Kids, and he was still alive then. He was 87 years old, and we went and talked to him and interviewed him. And Robin was supposed to throw out the first pitch at the Wilmington Blue Rocks first game. Robin had pitched half a season with the Blue Rocks before the Phillies called him up, and they had been without baseball for, I guess, 40-some years, and they had this was the first time they had a baseball team again, and they hadn't, and he had actually flown up to throw out the first pitch, and that's when we went to see Eddie Sawyer. Well, Eddie Sawyer lived on Valley Forge Mountain, which is a beautiful area, but it's not easy to get to. And it started pouring down rain, and we realized that we're a long way from Wilmington, Delaware, and it's the night game, and it's pouring down rain, and we got lost. We couldn't get off the mountain. We couldn't, and the only thing that saved us, I mean, we made it. By the time we got there, it was an hour late. The only thing that saved us, it was raining in Wilmington too, and so that means that the game was postponed, and we came back the next day, and he threw out the first pitch. And half the people in the stands had seen him pitch in 1948 for the Blue Rocks, it seems like. We went up to West Point that weekend, and his son Danny was coaching the West Point Army baseball, and just went to Atlantic City. We had an appearance in Atlantic City. And Duke Snyder and George Kell and were there, and I'm hanging out with those guys. It was just sort of magical. And I thought, well, this is going to cost me a lot of money to go to Atlantic City, because, you know, I figured rooms were expensive. And he said, no, you're staying with me. So I actually roomed with my boyhood hero. As I said, our friendship grew and grew to really love his wife Mary. They were devoted couple. Mary was the only girl literally he ever dated. And he met her when he came back from Michigan State one summer in Springfield, and she had just moved there to take a teaching job. The biggest thrill I used to get was when I would call Robin on the phone when we were working on the books. Mary would always answer the phone, and we would talk, and she'd ask about my kids, and I'd ask about how their grandkids were doing and the like. And then she'd say, well, let me get Robin, and she'd say, hey, Robin, it's Paul. You know, it's not Paul Rogers. It's not the guy from Texas. It's not that guy that's always bothering you. It's Paul. And that was just such a thrill that I was Paul to Robin. And so Robin would get on the phone, and he'd say, Paul who? Did it every time. He had a great sense of humor. One time when I was in Tampa, we went to the High Line match. I'd never been to High Line, and I didn't realize that you go to High Line to bet. That's why you go. It's like going to the horse races. I was supposed to pick up dinner that night because they bought my dinner the night before, and so I was going to pay for dinner But the manager of the High Line auditorium or facility recognized Robin, and so he comped us. So I didn't have to pay. And so I'm trying to learn how to bet, and we're betting on these matches. And I'm down about $20 or so because I'm cheap. And on the last match, I bet what's called a quinella, which is, you know, there are two guys on each team in the High Line, and they each have numbers. I bet number three and number six. 36 his number, and I won $50. They won. The odds were like, I don't know, 8-1 or something. And there's something in the air. One time we were working on the book, and I'd always wanted to ask him to play catch with me, and I was always a little bit timid about doing that. But one time, you know, we'd been at it for a while, and I said, hey, would you play catch with me? And so we went out, and he got a brand new baseball, brand new National League baseball out of a box, and went out in his front yard and played catch, and he was probably 68, 69 years old, and he still had real snap on the ball. And then he signed the ball for me, so I still have that ball. So we had so many great experiences. One of the interesting experiences we had is I got to meet James Michener. Michener had been a huge fan of Robin Roberts. Michener's from the Philadelphia area. And when we were doing the WizKids book, we wondered who should do the tribute and the foreword. And Robin wanted thought that James Michener would be perfect. And so I wrote Michener, who was in ill health living down in Austin, and we didn't get a response and didn't get a response and didn't get a response. And you know, we thought he's just too ill to do it. And so we asked somebody else to do it. And then in the mail, a few days later, comes a foreword from Michener to me, because I'd written the letter, and it was a little bit in rough shape because of his age. So I actually got to edit James Michener. after the WizKids book came out, we had a book signing in Dallas, and then the next day, Robin and I flew down to Austin and went to see Michener. He was on dialysis, and gave him a copy of our book, and we were smart enough to each bring him a copy and take a copy, a WizKids copy of the book for us, for him to sign for us. And so he did that, and he died just a few months after that. This book, Robin was reluctant to write this book for a while. He loved the WizKids book. He thought that was so much fun, but he didn't think that, you know, anybody really was that interested in an old pitcher. And I used to tell him, well, if people aren't interested, how come you get about 20 autographs requests in the mail every day? And how come you're flying all over the country doing memorabilia shows and people lining up? And I knew he had such a great memory, exquisite memory, and he was such a wonderful storyteller that I just knew that it ought to be, his story ought to be put down for posterity. So we finally got him to agree to do it, and the book was, the original hardback copy of the book was published in 2003, and then it did quite well, but it's been out of print for 8 or 9 years, and that's when he managed to get the trade paperback book out. I think he ultimately was very glad to have his memoirs out, I was looking through it today, sort of getting ready for this, and it just reminded me how many great stories that he had. I thought I'd close by just telling you a few of my favorites, one involves the 1950 season. The Phillies and the Dodgers were really big rivals in those days, because the Phillies were good and the Dodgers were good. The Dodgers won it almost every year. Robin's going to pitch in Ebbets Field against the Dodgers, and before the game, the clubhouse guy comes in and hands him a note, hands Robin a note, and it's a death threat. It says, if you take the mound today, you will be shot and killed. And so, Granny Hamner was the shortstop, and he was in the locker next door to Robin. And Robin showed it to Hamner, and Hamner's, don't take that seriously. And so Robin, he didn't report it. He just went out and warmed up and went out to pitch. When they got out on the field, Hamner said, I see him, he's up there, I see him on the roof over there. So just trying to unsettle him. So Robin still goes out, and he's thinking about it, and he throws the first pitch, and he dives down to the ground. And of course, nobody knows why he's done that, except Hamner, who's rolling at shortstop. And so the Dodgers scored two or three runs in the first inning against Robin, and before he got him out. And when they are coming off the field, Hamner runs by Robin and says, "Hey, Roberts, don't worry about getting shot today. You ain't got crap." So he pitched an exhibition game against Satchel Paige in Los Angeles after the season. They were barnstorming. And Satchel, who was probably, 45 or 50 maybe, had an Ephus pitch. He had a pitch where he threw it way up high and just came down like a softball pitch. that he mixed in with his other stuff. And he threw Robin an Eva's pitch when Robin was at bat, and Robin actually timed it and got a base hit up the middle. And so years later, they're at the Hall of Fame weekend, and Robin goes up to Satchel and says, "Hey, Satch, you remember that base hit I got against you in Los Angeles?" And Satchel said, "Roberts, I got a little black book with all the great hitters that I faced in it, and you're not there." He had a great relationship with Richie Ashburn. They came up. They both came up in '48, and of course they're both in the Hall of Fame. And Richie was the great center fielder. There's a picture of Robin and Richie that flashes by where Robin's got his arm around Richie, and they were old friends, and they roomed together for a while, and. Richie was just a little bit different kind of guy. He was a really smart guy, but just a little bit different. And so they roomed together, and then they would drive to the ballpark together. One time, Robin was driving, and he got pulled over for running a red light. And Ashburn's in the passenger seat. And Robin tells the officer, "Sir, I know that light was yellow. I know that was yellow." And Ashburn says from the passenger seat, "No, no, it wasn't. It was red." Robin said he sort of knew what he was facing with, what kind of guy Whitey was one time. Or he knew that Whitey was a little bit different when they went to a movie. They went to a cowboy movie one time during spring training. And all of a sudden, they're sitting in the theater, and there's the good guys and the bad guys. And somebody's saying, "Get him, you dirty rat. Get him, you dirty rat." And all of a sudden, Robin realized that was Ashburn yelling out to get the bad guy. He had a really sort of irreverent sense of humor. One story that's in the book is 55 All-Star Game. Robin's the starting pitcher, and before the game, they're going over the hitters. Leo DeRocher is the manager, and he wants to go over the hitters. The American League hitters. And so Robin came from an organization. He didn't want to go over the hitters. He knew that if he pitched the way he could pitch, he'd win. If he could control, work the corners. And so they were going over the hitters, and every hitter at Robin would say, high and tight, low and outside, high and tight, low and outside. Every hitter. And they came to Berra. They came to Yogi Berra, and Robin said, "Well, I don't know how to pitch him, but I'll tell you one thing. He's got a beautiful wife, and I don't know how he did it." And he said that Jackie Robinson was sitting next to him and literally fell off his stool. He used to tell great stories about other players. He was with the Yankees for a short time. And one story that he tells about Mickey Mantle was... Mantle was the Yankees were playing the Senators, Washington, the old Washington Senators, and Pedro Ramos was the pitcher for the Senators, and Ramos struck Mantle out to end the game with the tying and winning runs on base. So strikes Mantle out, the game's over. After the game, Ramos comes in the Yankees clubhouse and asks if Mantle will sign the ball. that he just struck out on. And so Mickey said, he's, "Yeah, okay, I'll sign it." So he signed it. And so the next time they face Ramos, Mantle's up, and he hits a ball 9 miles for a home run. And it just, it's probably one of the longest home runs he ever hit. And so he's running around the bases. And you know how, if you've seen pictures of Mantle, some of you probably saw him in person, the way he went around the bases with his head down, he didn't want to show up the pitcher, and he comes around third, and he looks over to Ramos, and he says to him, "I'll sign that one too if you can find it." Robin was noted for not throwing at people. He didn't brush people back, and that, you know, to some extent, hitters could dig in, and that probably didn't help him any. But he told me the only player he ever threw at least the only in the National League, was Ted Klazuski. And Klazuski, if you remember, had been a fullback at Indiana University. He was a big guy. His arms were huge. He was a first baseman slugger, and he cut off his jersey sleeve so that his arms would not get, you know, would show, and so he's pitching against the Reds and against Klazuski, and Klazuski hits a home run the first two times up. So he's got two home runs. He comes up again, and Robin said to himself, "That's about enough of that." So he plunks him right here in the bicep, just first pitch. And so Klazuski looks down, picks up the ball, and tosses it to Robin and goes to first base. Said it didn't exactly have the desired effect. He was a great admirer of Jackie Robinson. Robinson came up in 47, Robin came up in 48, and so they were certainly contemporaries. And in those days, with eight teams in a league, they played each other 22 times. So they played a lot of games, and the competition was really intense. And the year they won the pennant, they beat the Dodgers on the last day of the season in Ebbets Field in a dramatic 10-inning game. Roberts pitched that game. It was his third start in 5 days, and it's hard to believe. And he pitched 10 innings, and Dick Sisler hit a home run in the bottom of the 10th, actually the top of the 10th, rather, to win the game, and Robin got him out in the bottom of the 10th. And if you remember, when Robinson came up, the teams that were really the roughest on him racially were the Cardinals and the Phillies. The Phillies at that time in 47 were a veteran ball club, and they had a lot of Southerners on the team. Ben Chapman was the manager from Birmingham. Dusty Cook was from North Carolina. He was one of the coaches. They had several veteran ball players from the Deep South. And so they really were rough on him. Ben Chapman was particularly rough on him. Now, a lot of those guys were gone by 48, and almost all of them were gone by 1950. But after the Phillies won the pennant on the last day of the season in Ebbets Field, Jackie Robinson came into the Phillies dugout and went around and shook every Phillies player's hand and congratulated him. You know, which Robin said, you know, nobody ever called me a bad name, but I would have never thought of doing that at age 22 or 23. So, sort of just a remarkable. So Robin always really admired Robinson. You know, that's Stan Musial. And I've already talked about him, but what a great relationship they had, and how much Robin admired him. One interesting thing about this: this is the only opposing player that was hung in Robin's house. I mean, this picture was a picture that he had framed and hung in his house. This is his 1952 Topps baseball card. This was from his rookie year. You can tell because of the older style uniforms. It's before they went to the pinstripes. So this was from 48 or maybe 49. This is the 1950 team. Robin's on the far left, your far left. And these are the Whiz Kids. They were a bunch of young kids, one of the younger teams ever to win the National League pennant. They were also the last all-white team to win the National League pennant. If you think about it, the Dodgers had won before, and afterwards the Giants and the Dodgers won, and the Phillies, unfortunately, were one of the last teams to integrate, and it really is part of the reason they were not very good in the late 50s. Roy Campanella was from Philadelphia, the great Dodgers catcher, and wanted to play for the Phillies, and they wouldn't even give him a tryout. So if you can imagine how good they would have been if they had guys like Campanella. This is when they won the pennant. This is after he got the Dodgers out in the bottom of the 10th, and he's being carried off the field. Dick Sisler is number 8. He's the guy that hit the home run in the top of the 10th to put him ahead. Robin had pitched 9 innings and was the leadoff batter in the top of the 10th, and they didn't pitch hit for him. I mean, they just kept him in. He was going to pitch till the game was over. That's Richie Ashburn and Robin. And that's in the clubhouse at Ebbets Field after they won the pennant in 1950. This is an interesting picture. He went to Michigan State at the tail end of World War II in one of the Armed Forces programs, and he played basketball there. He was a really good basketball player, and he's getting presented the trophy. I've actually seen this trophy. It's for the top college basketball player in the state of Michigan, and they're presenting it to him at a Michigan State baseball game. And what's sort of interesting about his career at Michigan State is I was telling my friend Todd before, he played basketball and he sort of went out for baseball in the spring because he wanted something to do. He was used to playing all the sports. And so the coach, this guy named John Cobb, said, what position do you play? And Robin said, what position do you need? And Cobb said, well, you know, we can always use pitching. And Robin said, well, I'm a pitcher. And he had barely pitched in high school. He mostly played third base. He pitched just a little bit. 2 years from that date, with 2 years and a few months, maybe 2 or 3 months, he was in the major leagues pitching for the Phillies. I mean, he just had a God-given talent. Just amazing. This is the Polo Grounds for sure. You can tell from the facade. I think this is a great shot. You can see how low his right leg is, how he almost skimmed the ground.
Since I'm a few years older than you, I remember this Whiz Kid team pretty well. Followed it closely, and Robin Roberts, one of my heroes. But something you said earlier, my question is, I recall, I'm checking my memory, the first baseman did get shot somewhere that year and had to be replaced by Dick Sisler, did he not? Eddie Waitkus?
Eddie Waitkus, that's a great question. He got shot the year before in 49.
Okay.
And then he almost died. He had 4 operations. And for those of Eddie, I mean, this people always say this is sort of the Eddie Waitkus shooting by a deranged female fan was what formed the basis of The Natural. Where Malamud got the idea. That's what they say. Malamud never said that, but it does make some sense. So he's out for the rest of 49, but he goes to Florida all winter and rehabs and works his way back. And so in 50, he's the first baseman. I think he played 152 games. So it was a remarkable comeback story. Waitkus was one of the best fielders. He was a slash hitter, but one of the best fielding first basemen in the league, if not the best.
But am I remembering correctly when he did get shot that Dick Sisler replaced him?
Yes, yes.
He was the son of another great baseball player from the past.
That's right, yeah. Yeah, Sisler had been playing in the outfield. I have a question for you. Who was the second baseman on the Whiz Kids?
Goliath.
All right.
The rest of them, if you want to hear it.
Goliath only played 1 year in the big league. So if you know that Goliath was the Whiz Kids' second baseman, you're a real Phillies fan.
I have gotten, almost, what would you call it? Addicted to complete games, and I tell my children,
or the lack thereof, right?
Yeah, where are they? I tell my children and a couple of my older grandchildren, you know, stories about Ferguson Jenkins when he was with the Rangers in 74 and he had, you know, like 27 complete games
right.
1 year. And so when I saw your little publicity release on the Robin Roberts deal, and then I opened it and read, is this right? 305 complete games in his career?
Yes, yeah, yeah. And when you consider, in his heyday, he probably completed. I had to figure this, but I bet he completed about 80% of the games he started in that 6 year span where he won 20 or more games.
I mean, that's just
over 300 innings, six straight years. 300. They would actually bring him in relief between starts.
But I mean, how do you have 305 complete games? It's just impossible now. They don't even think about that anymore.
No, just and you know, he of course he was fortunate. He didn't have arm trouble till really late in his career. He had bone chips that finally developed when he was probably 37 or 8 years old.
Have you ever had the opportunity to attend one of the Hall of Fame induction ceremonies at Cooperstown?
I'm so glad you asked that question.
I wished I had, especially this year when they had all the Braves, Bobby Cox.
Did you go this year?
No. Oh. I've never been to one. I'd love to.
I've only been to one, and it was because of Robin Roberts. He invited me to come as his guest, and I took a friend, Weber Bell, that Chuck probably knew, and we went up for the induction weekend in 1998, and it was Robin never missed. He was inducted in the Hall of Fame in 1976, and until he died, he never missed an induction weekend. He would rent a house for his family, for his kids, his boys and his grandkids would come, and they'd spend the weekend. And so, and Mary found us a place to stay right behind Doubleday Field. It was, in fact, when they had the home run derby, the balls were landing right on top of the garage apartment where we were staying. And one of the neat things about that weekend for me was Don Sutton was inducted that year, and Larry Doby was inducted that year, the first African American player in the American League. And Rob, the day of the induction, Robin was playing golf with Doby and told me to come drive the cart. So I drove the cart. He didn't really want me to play, which was okay. It would have slowed things down, but. Because we had VIP status, we had access to the Otisega lobby, you know, where all the Hall of Famers hang out, and we had access to VIP receptions at the hall. So, you know, after that, I'd love to go back, but I'm not sure it would be the same.
Talk a little bit about the guy that the Japanese pitcher that emulated Robin Roberts and became like the winningest pitcher in the Japanese leagues. That was during one of his trips.
Yeah, that's an interesting story. When Robin he went over barnstorming in Japan a couple of times after the season. They Major League All-Star teams would go over and play Japanese professional teams. And in 1953, he went with a team called the Eddie Lopat All-Stars. And there's a picture of that team in the book. Eddie Robinson was on that team. If some of you were at the Eddie Robinson program we had here, he was the first baseman on that team. And so they played a bunch of games and then years later, they were at a Don Drysdale charity golf tournament in Arizona. This was probably 1990 or something like that, and there was a Japanese couple across the room, and the woman kept pointing at Robin, you know, like making him a little bit uncomfortable, And finally, the couple went over. She spoke a little of English. He did not. And she said, "You're Kanata's teacher. You're Kanata's teacher." And the story is, and Kanata was her husband, great Japanese pitcher, left-handed pitcher, won over 400 games. He's a legend in Japan, won over 400 games in Japan, left-handed pitcher. The story is that when they were over there in 53, this Kanata was like a 17-year-old kid, and he copied Robin's pitching motion. even though he was left-handed, he emulated that drop and drive pitching motion, and you know only won 400 and some games with it. That's a really remarkable story. And so Kanata, the end of the story is Kanata was managing one of the Japanese teams at that time, and said, "Robin, you know, come over to spring training and help work with our pitchers." And so the next spring, Robin and Mary went over, flew first class to Japan, and you know they were feted, and he worked with them in spring training. A little funny thing that happened was in Japan, you know, they practice, and so that the team would get up at they'd be on the field at 7:30 in the morning. They'd be doing calisthenics for an hour, and then they work on fundamentals, and they worked out till from 7:30 with about a 30-minute lunch for a sushi lunch, a 30-minute break for a sushi lunch, until about 4:30 or 5 in the afternoon. And Robin said to Kanata one day, said, "Don't you think you're working these guys a little bit hard? I mean, you know, you got to." It seems like they're out in the hot sun a long time. And Kanata's answer was, "Japanese baseball is different." And it's different.
Paul, nice talk.
Thanks, Howard. Good to see you.
Same. I wonder if you'd comment on his pitching motion and whether that had anything to do with his longevity or his lack of arm problems. And is that motion actually a better motion for pitchers?
I think it is. He was very. Kurt Simmons was another great pitcher on that team. Kurt was a left-hander who had better stuff. I mean, he threw hard, but Kurt had arm problems most of his career. And if you ever see Kurt Simmons. Motion. It's very herky-jerky, and he threw across his body. And I've kept up with Kurt, and he's had two knee replacements and two hip replacements. I mean, it's just the pounding that he took. He pitched about 18 years. Robin really never had any kind of health problems. One of the things that he told me that was the key to his delivery was he learned how to snap the ball at the end of his motion. And that gave the ball a hop, the sort of interesting story. He after he pitched that first spring at Michigan State, he beat Michigan at the last game of the season, and the Michigan coach was Ray Fisher, a legendary guy, and Ray saw him pitch and invited him to Vermont, and to pitch in the summer league up there, and. So he went up there and pitched, and then came back and pitched at Michigan State. And no, I guess that was the summer. No, that summer he came back after the season in Vermont, and he played in a couple of semi-pro games in Springfield. And he pitched to his old high school catcher, and his high school catcher said, "What happened to you? You never threw like that before." I mean, so. When he really found himself out, up in Vermont, and I think working with Ray Fisher. Ray Fisher was one of the pitchers for the Cincinnati Reds that played against the Chicago Black Sox in 1919. So he was a pitcher, and he worked with Robin's motion. And there was a when they would ask when Fisher lost the only game he pitched in that World Series. He pitched a game against Dickie Williams. Of the Black Sox, and Dickie was one of the honest guys. So Ray Fisher used to say, "Yeah, he had to pitch against the only guy that was trying."